what the information you are going to collect from the environment, or what you are going to feel from the environment. That is called perception. That is our perception. And what the idea you are going to create over it, that is called perception. So this percepts, this word has came from this word perception. And the agent is collecting information from the environment, and this information or the piece of information is called as percepts. Okay. And how the agent is going to collect these percepts from the environment? Using various kind of sensors. Using various kind of sensor circuit. There are various kind of sensors are available right now. Sensor technology has improved in an apex position. So we nowadays we have various kind of sensors in our hand, and almost all of these sensors are available in market also. Okay, so there also you will get some similarity. Agents here, that's why I have embed this James Bond trailer video before going to deep again of this agent section. That just like a human agent or just like a human being, agent is going to collect information or gather information from the environment, and according to that information, by analyzing this information, just like a human agent, this AI based agent is also going to react or going to act over the environment. So a human being or a human agent is going to collect this information from the environment using his or her sensory organs like eye, nose, ear, skin, all of these sensory organs, using these sensory organs. Okay. And here also you can see these AI based intelligent agents are capable of gathering or collecting information from the environment using these sensory networks. There are so many sensors available right now. What I've said, that is, heat sensors are there, chemical sensors are there, water sensors are there. So many sensors are there already. So agents can very equipedly, collect information from the environment. And the fundamental faculties or the fundamental features of an intelligent agent, that is sensing, understanding, reasoning, learning, and acting. All of these features are, I think, present in James Bond also. So that's why there is the similarity between these two. Only that's all. Okay, so sensing, understanding, reasoning, learning, and acting. And all of these features should be combined in a real-time framework. So that agents can react upon it in a real-time fashion or in a real-time manner. Otherwise, we are collecting information today, and tomorrow agent is going to act on the environment. That type of agent is of no use. So everything, the sensing, understanding, reasoning, learning, and acting, all of these actions, all of these layers should work seamlessly and in a very real-time fashion, real-time manner. Okay, so these are the different kinds of environment. When we put agent or when we develop an agent for some particular work or some particular job, the environment can be classified in these five categories. The environment of an agent can be classified in these five categories, and according to these different categorical environment, agent is pre-planned or pre-programmed accordingly. So the first environment is observability. Okay, these are basically, you can see that these are not all time it is not that kind of clear classification. These are basically the features of an agent environment, you can say that also. So observability, that means you can recall the example of hill climbing algorithm. That is, the environment is fully observable or partially observable. either the environment is fully observable or partially observable. It means that when the AI system will work, this system can gather or collect information fully or partially from the environment. This is called the range or basically the level of information the agent is gathering. Depending on that, we can say that this is the degree of observability. This is the degree of observability of an environment. Either it is fully or it is partially to some extent. Okay, so this is called observability of environment. Second one is determinism. Okay, determinism, just like the word deterministic. It is coming from the word deterministic. The meaning of deterministic is that very precise. When we can predict something very precisely, that is called deterministic. Or when we can get the idea of something in a very precise manner, in a very correct manner, that is called deterministic. Okay. So deterministic environment is that being in the current state, if the agent is capable of describe the next state, then this type of environment is called as deterministic environment. Example, say when say it is like that. The example can be like that, very simple. Say we are in the, there is a staircase with 10 steps. There is a staircase with 10 steps. So say now we are going to upwards direction. We are climbing the staircase from the bottom to the above position. And say we are in fifth step. So this environment is very much deterministic, because as we are going upwards, so after fifth step, if we are starting from say one, then after fifth step, obviously we will be in the next sixth step. So it is very much deterministic. There is no confusion for that. If we are going upwards to a staircase by climbing a staircase, and if we are currently in fifth step, then the next step will be the sixth one. So this is very much deterministic. Another example can be like this. If a car is running in 60 kilometer per hour, and in the current instance of time, if we can measure the position of the car, and after 5 minutes, it is very much deterministic step. It is very much deterministic environment. So that we can surely describe that in the next step, say after 5 minutes, the car will be 5 kilometer ahead. Okay, 5 kilometer ahead from the current position. So the environment is very much deterministic. If we consider that the acceleration and all the other parameters remain same, then the next step or the next state of the car will be 5 kilometer ahead from the current position after 5 minutes. So these type of environments are called as deterministic environment. Okay. The third one is called as episodicity. Episodicity. Episodicity, this word has came from the word episodic or episode. Or you can say that the base word is episode. From this word episode, this word has been coined, that is episodicity. Episodicity, that just like opposite of this deterministic environment. It is just opposite the deterministic environment. That is episodicity tells that the subsequent episode, okay, are not dependent with each other. Okay, episodic environment means that the subsequent episodes do not depend on what actions occurred in previous episode. It is action independent. The environment is action independent. Example, if I give you an example, it will be easy to understand. That is, example is, say, meteorological data collection, weather forecasting. Okay, we are using the same statistical survey model, which includes all kind of meteorological condition or kind of weather forecasting model are integrated, and this platform is continuously observing the parameters from our environment to predict about the future weather. Okay, so when weather changes from the sunny weather to say a cloudy weather, rainy weather, okay, if weather changes like this time to time, but the agent, the structure of the agent or the action of the agent to the environment is not changing. In an episodic manner, weather or the environment can change from sunny to cloudy, from cloudy to rainy. This change can happen. But the agent we have developed for collecting information or collecting data regarding this change of the weather, that action is not changing. They are collecting in the same way. They are collecting the data in same way. Okay, so this is because this type of AI agent is not doing anything, is not doing any action over the environment. They are just their action. Yes, they act obviously, but that action is not affecting the environment. Environment is changing time to time according to the nature of the environment, but the system is only acts like that. It will only collect the information, it will only collect the data from this changing environment and put this data for further analysis. So this can be one example of this episodicity. Okay, the fourth one is dynamism. It is again basically the opposite of this episodicity, because here dynamic environment change over time independent of the action of the agent. Okay, dynamic environment changes over time independent of the action of the agent, and thus if an agent does not respond in a quickly manner, this count as a choice do not nothing. That means the environment is changing very quickly. Now, if the agent is unable to respond according to this quick change of the environment, then it will be taken as the choice of the agent that to do nothing. Agent is idle. So that kind of environment which changes itself very quickly over time, this is called dynamic environment, just like the example of weather forecasting. Okay, or I can give you another example, that is a car is moving. Again, an example of a moving car. The car is moving with the time, it is changing its position. Now, if there is any AI agent is there to track anything about the movement of the car or about the movement of any moving object in a particular area, like surveillance system. Okay, the surveillance system is a very good example of this dynamism. Surveillance system has been prepared or has been planned to collect the data, to gather the data of a particular area for any moving object in that particular area. Now, it should be very much real time. Suppose someone is running across that area, and if that surveillance system is not been capable to respond or to take picture, whatever the action it's supposed to do, that is taking picture or alarming something like that. So if the surveillance system is failed to do that, that means the system is do nothing against this dynamic environment. Okay, so this is called as dynamic environment, and opposite is static environment, which doesn't change at all from one state to the next state. Okay, and the last one is continuity. That means if the number of distinct percepts, that means what we are collecting from the environment, they are very much distinct. They are basically distinct, means they are different from each other. Say in a particular time lapse, in a particular time duration, the agent is going to collect, say, 30 pieces of information or 30 number of percepts from the environment, and these 30 number of percepts are different from each other. There is no repetition. There are no similarity. Maybe there are similarity, but as per data, there is no repetition. Okay, so these kind of percepts are called as distinct percept. And for each and every distinct percept, if the action of the agent is different also, then it is called as, then this environment is called as discrete environment. Otherwise, it is called as continuous environment. That means within a time lapse, if the AI agent is collecting, has been collected 30 percepts, and all of these percepts are different to each other, they are distinct in nature, and the system is going to react according to this 30 number of different or distinct percepts in a distinct way. Okay, then the environment is called as discrete environment. Otherwise, it is called as continuous. That means all the 30 percepts are similar kind of percepts. So the course of action of the AI system or the intelligent agent according to these percepts are also similar kind of action. So these are continuous environment. Otherwise, it is called as discrete environment. Okay, so these are the five agent environments or environmental features an agent can face. So now just tell me if there is any problem, if there is any query. Up to this, you can ask me. If there is any query up to this, you can ask me. Okay, so I think there is no query, so we can proceed for the next slide. Agent architecture. Okay, agent architecture. A generic architecture of an agent is called as subsumption architecture. This is the generic architecture of any agent. This is the core architecture, you can say. It is the core architecture present in every agent architecture. Over this core subsumption architecture, there may be some other plugins or other addition can be there, other modifications can be there, but this is the core architecture of any AI agent. So what are the main features of this architecture? That is, there is no explicit knowledge representation. Okay, no explicit knowledge representation. Obviously, when an agent is first working in the environment, obviously there is no explicit knowledge representation for this agent. After gathering a substantial amount of data, after collecting substantial amount of data or enough data from the environment, then the agent is capable of getting some explicit knowledge representation about it. Otherwise, initially there is no explicit knowledge representation for agent architecture. Behavior is distributed, not centralized. Every agent architecture is a not centralized, depending on not, it is not depending on centralized architecture, because its behavior is distributed. Because agent, when we have created an agent or we have created an AI, any kind of AI system or AI agent, it is not like that there is only a single agent. And this single agent is nothing but a program which can act accordingly, according to some logic, which can act to the environment. So when we have created or when we have designed this AI-enabled programs or AI-enabled agents, it is not like that it is a single program, it is a single code. It is not like that. Okay, there are in different decentralized position, there are so many agents are distributed.
केशव म्यूट कर लो।
हेलो कैन यू हियर मी?
यस सर।
ओके सो वेरी सॉरी देयर इज एन बेसिकली इंटरनेट इशू इन माय साइड, ब्रॉडबैंड वाज सडनली गॉन, दैट्स व्हाई। एनीवे सो वी हैव ओके we can start from here again. Okay, so we were discussing about this subsumption architecture, that was behavior is distributed, not centralized. It means that what I'm going to tell you, that is what I'm discussing, that is an AI agent means it is not a single program, it is not a single program designed to do any particular job or any precise job. It is basically a threaded program, and so many cloned thread program is running in a simultaneous way, and each and every program is interacting. Okay, each and every program or each and every agent is interacting with each other to make this distributed environment. Okay, to create this distributed environment, because it is not possible, say for an example, if we want to make an intelligent surveillance system in Newtown Rajarhat area, so it is not possible that in only a single machine or in only a single device we are running some AI program or AI agent code, and that will create the total environment so that we can make the surveillance of this entire region. It is not possible. So we have to create this distributed architecture so that these agent threads can run in different devices throughout this total region, and all of these different agent threads will communicate with each other, and all the data can be processed centrally or can be processed in a distributed server system also. Okay, so this is a totally distributed architecture that is said here. And the next feature is response to stimuli is reflexive. The word reflexive, this means that in no time. The meaning of this word reflexive is in no time. That means real-time response. Okay, so the response to the stimuli is reflexive, that I have already told you. The AI agent, the response or the action time of an AI agent should be very much reflexive or very much in possessed in real-time manner. Okay, so the design is bottom-up. Subsumption architecture design is bottom-up, and complex behaviors are fashioned from combination of simpler underlying ones. Okay, so the architecture, when I will just explain you the architecture, you will see that it's a bottom-up architecture. That is basically the design features of the subsumption architecture. Okay, and the individual agents are simple. The individual agents are simple, but when multiple threads of these individual agents will create a total intelligent architecture, that is not a simple. The behavior of this total architecture is not simple, that is complex. So this is basically the features of subsumption architecture, basic features of this architecture. Now we are going to study how it can work. Okay, as you can see here, we have, for an example, we have taken the example of this is called Brooks mobile robot. This particular example is called as Brooks mobile robot. It is a very simple wheel moving robot on wheel or on casters. Okay, so this is called Brooks mobile robot. This robot is created for pathfinding purpose. Okay, for pathfinding purpose, what you are actually habituated to see in our college, that robo fight type of games, what the students have organized, that is a robo soccer or something like that. All of these are based on this Brooks mobile robot architecture. These are the simplest. These are the simplest robotic architecture ever found. That is a very basic and naive architecture. As you can see in this model, you can see here
Okay, so these are the in the left hand side of this architecture, there are the sensors. These are the sensor architecture. So many sensors, multiple number of sensors and multiple types of sensors can be used. So from these sensors, we are getting input. From these sensors, we are getting input from the environment. We are getting input from the environment. And these inputs, as you can see in this architecture of Brooks mobile robot, these inputs are going through three sections. There are three sections. As I have told you, this is basically a very primitive type and very initial type robotic design. So only three analytical parts are there. One is explore. Sorry, I have told you that is it's a very simple, individually very simple architecture. So as you can see here, there are three analytical parts. One is explore, another is wonder, and another is avoid. So using these three analytical parts, this architecture is going to react over the environment, is going to act over the environment through the effector part. Effector, EFFECTOR, effector. The meaning of this effector is by which part the agent is going to act over the environment. Here the effector is this motor. There is a motor. It can be any kind of motor is that. But using this motor, this robot can move. Okay, using this motor, this robot can move. So this motor is the effector. So in one side of the architecture, there is a sensor network. In another side of this architecture, there is an effector. It can be a motor for any moving robot. It can be a motor for any other type of AI agent. It can be anything. It can be any robotic arm, or it can be any kind of effector device. Okay. So effector is the device by which, or the part of the device by which that AI agent is going to respond or going to act over the environment. For this Brooks mobile robot, this effector is a motor. Okay. So sensors are collecting data from the environment. Now this data is going to, using this data, analyzing this data, the robot first is going to wonder. Wonder means it will check. Just again, you can recall your hill climbing example. Wondering means it will just, anyone can tell me what is wonder? What is wondering action? Any one of you? What do you mean by wondering?
Sir, it will fetch for possible direction to proceed.
Exactly. It will search or it will wander its locality. It will wander its locality for all the possible options. All the possible options to explore further. This is the wander action. So first the robot will wander for the possible routes, for the possible paths, and after selecting this possible path, it will explore. Then it will go for exploring that path. After exploring this path, until and unless, you can see here, there is a loop. There is a loop between explore and wander. As you can see in this architecture, there is a loop between explore and wander. So after wandering, when the robot will get the possible path, it will explore that path until and unless it is facing some obstruction. Until and unless it is facing some obstruction, it will explore that path. Explore and wander. Repetitively, these two actions will be called. Okay? Until and unless the robot is going to face any obstruction. Whenever it is going to face any obstruction, then the robot will go for avoidance action. When the robot will face any obstruction, it will try to avoid this option and try to explore a new path. So this is the algorithm this Brooks mobile robot follows. So as you can see here, the system is built in three layers. Layer zero, avoid obstacles. Layer one, wonder behavior. As you can see here, as I have already told you, the subsumption architecture is a bottom-up architecture. Bottom-up. So as you can see here, layer zero is avoid obstacles. Layer one, then if it can avoid obstacles, then wonder. After avoiding obstacles, it will wonder for new possibilities. Okay, so wonder behavior. Then the third layer, that is exploration behavior. After wondering, when the robot will be able to find out the most promising path or most promising route, it will try to explore. Okay, it will start exploring that path or that route. Okay, until and unless, again in layer zero, loop back to layer zero. Again, until and unless it will face some obstacles. When it will face some obstacles, again it will repeat. Avoid obstacles, then again wander, then again explore the new path. So this is the in cyclic order. This Brooks mobile robot will move through the obstacles, will search out its path through different obstacles. Okay. So this is basically the most primitive and basic model of obstruction pathfinding robots. Okay. So it maintains this subsumption architecture. I think all of you have seen these robots made by our students for different Tech Fest program. Yes, there is a particular event that is Robo Soccer or something like that. Students are going to organize using different kinds of moving robots. But all of these robots are basically, when the students of different departments, they are going to design these robots, they are not at all aware of the basic architecture of this robot. They are just following the instructions available in YouTube or internet. But the basic architecture behind this robot is Brooks mobile robot architecture. And it is based on the intelligent agent subsumption architecture of AI. Okay, so any problem or any question up to this, any query up to this, you can ask me. Otherwise, we are going to end this agent section. Any problem or any query if you have, you can ask me. Okay. So these are the different types of agents. There are three types of agents. The first one is goal-based agent. Very easy to understand. Single point agenda. The agent is following a single point agenda. There is a single goal of this agent, and based on this goal, agent is act over the environment. That is called goal-based agent. Just like the example I have told you in my last class, previous class, that is you can take that example of that ICBM, that missile, guided missile, intercontinental ballistic missile. It is called as ICBM. So this ICBM is a radar controlled pre-programmed missile which is built to lock on a particular target, and there is no other goal for this. This is called goal-based agent. These are called goal-based agent. Or you can say that this is one example. And the second one, as you can see here, utility-based agent. Utility-based agent is a conditional agent. Conditional agent framework. Okay, more generalized. Okay, so this agent can have multiple goals. Other than the single goal-based agent, this type of utility-based agents can have multiple goals. Okay, and depending on different conditions or different constraints, this agent is allowed to choose its goal through the set of multiple goals. Okay, so this kind of agent is called as utility-based agent. That means there is some either or option choosing part is there. agent can choose its goal. Agent can choose its goal from multiple set of goals depending on some particular heuristics or constraints. That is called as utility-based agent. They have multiple goals and more generic architecture, more generic framework. Okay, so learning-based agent. The last one is learning-based agent. Both of these goal-based or utility-based agents, these are basically not a learning-based agent because they have hard-coded. There is nothing to learn for these two agents, goal-based agent and utility-based agent. They have nothing to learn from the environment. They have created just to perform a specific number of actions, specific number of jobs. Okay, they have built for that. So there is no learning required at all for these agents. They have hard-coded with some heuristics and constraints, and according to that pre-planned program, these agents will act over the environment. But learning-based agent is an autonomous agent. That is the first time you have heard about this thing. This is called autonomous agent. These agents are free to respond over the environment according to their instructions. Okay, because these agents are free to learn from the environment, what the information and what the percepts they will gather from the environment through their sensor network, they will analyze this information, analyze these percepts, and according to this analyzation, these agents are capable of gathering knowledge. These agents are capable of gathering knowledge and creating the knowledge base. So after learning from the, when I say there is 100 set of percepts are there, and it is like that, after learning from 70 number of percepts, the agent will create its own knowledge base. And now depending on this knowledge base, agents will act the remaining 30 or the remaining 20 number of percepts to the environment. This is called learning of the agent. Okay, this learning can be of two types. One is supervised learning and another is unsupervised learning. We will learn the supervised and unsupervised learning later. You have detailed module for this learning of agent. So for right now, you can understand that these learning-based agents are autonomous agents which are allowed to collect information through their sensory networks from the environment, and they are capable of analyzing this information or these percepts. And according to this analyzation, they are able to create their own knowledge base, depending on which these agents can act over the environment for this similar type of percepts. For these similar types of percepts, agents are capable of respond to the environment. Okay, so these are called learning-based agents. That means, for an example, I can tell you again the example of this Mangalyaan or the Mars rover India has created and placed in the surface of Mars. So this is a learning-based agent. The environment is totally unknown to that particular device, and now it is just following this subsumption architecture that avoid obstacles, then wander, and then explore. Using this basic subsumption architecture, this Mars rover is moving over the Mars surface, and actually it is following a star algorithm, which we will study later. After one or two class, we will study a star algorithm. So according to this algorithm, but whatever the algorithm this agent is going to follow, the basic architecture is same. That is the subsumption architecture. That is avoid obstacle, then wander, then explore. Explore until and unless you are facing again an obstacle. And if you face any obstacle, again loop back to the layer zero and again start from avoid obstacle, then wander, then explore.
in this way, in a cyclic order, it will repeat. Okay, so these are called learning-based agent. What I'm talking about, Mars rover, this Mangalyaan is going to collect data by its sensory network, like camera and all the other sensors. It will try to collect information about its visible, about its from its visible area, and depending on this information, analyzing this information, this is going to proceed further, which is again unknown to this Mangalyaan, unknown to this Mars rover. Okay, so it is completely moving depending on the knowledge base or the learning system it has. The knowledge base it is creating depending on its learning system. The knowledge base it has created, depending on this knowledge base, it is going to start exploring the unknown areas of Mars surface. So that's why it is obviously a truly autonomous agent. Okay, so these are the three agents we can create using these AI systems. Besides, these are the main three agents. Besides these, there are some other categories also, which are called as you can see here, table-based agent, percept-based agent, reflex agent, state-based agent. All of these are the different kinds of agents. But the main categories of the agents, the main categories of these agents are these three: goal-based agent, utility-based agent, and learning-based agent. Okay, so anything else you want to ask me, any query, any problem, you can ask me if you have any question. Because we are going to end our today's session, today's class. So if you have any query, you can ask me. So in the next class, we will start to study these agents' actions, like avoid obstacles, wandering, and then explore. These three options, if you think about these three options, they are basically of searching and sorting, whatever we can do, a computer can do, that is searching and sorting type algorithms, obviously. And we will study some specific algorithms which can actually explain this agent architecture. Okay, in AI, artificial intelligence, in AI, this searching technique can be divided in two broad category according to the nature of searching. One is called as heuristic based search, and another is called as adversarial search. Heuristic based search, and the second one is called as adversarial search, searching algorithms. So first we will start with heuristic based search, because you are much more familiar with this heuristic based search. So far you have studied, so far what the algorithms you have studied so far, all of these are heuristic based searching algorithms, but all of these are the procedural algorithm. Here you are going to get the flavor of non-procedural algorithm or AI based algorithm, which is much more different than your previously studied procedural algorithms. But the nature of these algorithms are obviously heuristic based. And after completion of this heuristic based algorithm, we will start adversarial search. And this adversarial search, you will going to get the flavor of autonomous or truly intelligent AI agents. Okay, because in adversarial search, the main algorithm we will study, that is, someone of you have already, I think, heard about this particular world-changing discovery, world-changing exploration, or world-changing discovery invention, I can say that. That is called game theory. I think some of you have already heard about this game theory. Anyone?
यस सर, जो मतलब इनपुट डेटा से खुद का कुछ एक अलग क्रिएट करता है, हाल फिलहाल में ही सर लॉन्च हुआ है, आई गेस।
यस, Game theory is basically a mathematical or economical theory, economics based on economical theory. Initially, it was created by the great mathematician that is John Nash in Princeton University. After that, he was in MIT. So he has created this game theory for a different use, basically for market study and market economics, to balance the market economics. Okay, balance the market economics. He has created or he has invented this game theory. It's a truly mathematical or statistical model, rather to say, statistical model. And it is basically based on governing dynamic statistics. Okay, so this model has been adapted in various different phases in this world, various different phases in banking sector, in share market, in normal any kind of normal factory inventory system, and ultimately in AI system also, artificial intelligence system also, to predict. This game theory has been used to predict the winning situation of the user through any adverse situation. That's why this game theory is called that adversarial search. That means game theory will help you in AI. Game theory is used to find out the winning path for the user within a very adverse situation, when the situation is very much critical and completely against you, completely against the user, then how you will find your correct path, how you will find your most possible path, that can be created, that can be explored by this game theory. And whatever I have said you earlier in my last class, that is A Beautiful Mind, a cinema, a movie, Hollywood movie, that is A Beautiful Mind. It is a Oscar awarded movie. So this Beautiful Mind was about the biography of the great mathematician John Nash. Okay, you can see that movie. It's a must see movie. Okay, so today I'm going to just end my class here, just after showing you a short video. After showing you a short video, it will take just 2 to 3 minutes to show this video. All of you can see the video?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. You can see here the most difficult part for any AI system, for any humanoid robotic system. This is the most difficult part, to climbing through the staircase. What I have shown you, do you know the name of this humanoid robot? This is the world's first human capable of human intelligence. It is the world's first humanly intelligent humanoid robot. Do you know the name of this robot?
Sir, Atlas.
No, not Atlas.
Asimo, sir. Asimo, I guess.
Yes. Asimo. It was created or manufactured by Honda. It was world's first nowadays, now, right now, there are so many versions of Asimo they have created, but it was, this version was the first humanly intelligent humanoid robot created by the Honda. The name of this robot was Asimo, and Asimo was the first humanoid robot capable of climbing staircase, capable of showing the human-like responses. Just you can see in this short video, it was capable of showing human-like responses, and it was first robot capable of climbing staircase. Because if you just think about how a human can climb up a stair, it is a very complex action, complex bodily action. If you think about the kinematics, it is called as the body movement of a human being. If you think about that, staircase climbing is a very complex type of body kinematics. But Asimo was capable to adapt this staircase climbing, and so many humanly responsive instances Asimo was capable to adapt. So that's the short video I want to show you. This is the thing. In the next class, we will start with the problem space and state space search algorithms. Okay, what I have told you, heuristic based algorithms, we'll start with that. So that's all for today's class. So thank you very much. I think all of you have enjoyed the class. Okay, see you in the next class tomorrow. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Okay, who has started this recording?